I heard a cover version of the Petty song. It wasn't him, and it was a broken down version where it was, it just felt, had a lot of feels to it, a lot of feeling to it. In the original Tom Petty version, I liked the song, but it felt really poppy to me. I loved the lyrics, but I felt like it was too happy how it was played, maybe too poppy. And so I had heard this other version of the song, a cover version, and it got stuck in my head.
Well, Rick was very enthusiastic about it, as he is about most things. So he sent me the link to the version that he liked, and I listened to it and really liked it. It was a fresh take on the song, and he wanted me to throw some ideas out about how we might record it, and it was fun to think about that. And actually, I came to like the song more than the original.
Previously, you know, this song was just a fun song to kind of rock out to when it came on the radio and sing along to, and I never paid much attention to it till Rick kind of brought it to the table and said he wanted to do it. So listening to the original Tom Petty version and the Luke Vital Singh versions, kind of a bit different, and I really enjoyed immersing myself into it. And so it'll mean something to me for the rest of my life now, for sure, having recorded it. And how much it means to Rick and his wife.
You know, Tom Petty, you're never gonna top Tom Petty. I mean, Tom Petty is amazing. So we were gonna try to top the song, but we tried to create a version, I think, that was more meaningful for us and meant something, and using the bones of his song. I feel like the Lumineers and Judah and the Lion, they've given that feel to their songs, where it sounds like they're in a bar, some sort of a setting, or maybe it's, you know, church, after church, and they just start playing, and this comes out, and someone just happened to be recording it. And that's what we tried to do with this song too. We wanted to have that feel of just spontaneity. And to achieve that, actually, we had never played the song together before we went and recorded it. And so I think that added to the sound of spontaneity. It added to some stress for people a little bit, I think, doing it. But I wanted it to sound imperfect. I wanted the feel to be there and have the structure to be there, but for it to have just a real emotional, imperfect sound, and think we got that. So the song American Girl, not necessarily the lyrics of it, but the feel of it and just the soul of American Girl reminds me of my wife and her values and her energy and her drive and her self-sufficiency and dreams and goals. Just her, she is just American Girl to me. And so when I was putting this together for her, I had her in mind the whole time. And she questioned that a little bit, because, you know, she was like, are you sure? Really? You know, you've had me in mind with this? I'm like, yeah. Are you sure? And I'm like, yeah. And it's because...
she's not American.
She's not American.
Yeah, so I think when Rick told me he wanted to do American Girl, I was kind of like, okay, well, I'm not really the American Girl, because I was born in Sweden and my mom is Peruvian, my dad is Swedish. So it's kind of far off from, I mean, yeah, I've lived here for 20 something years now, but I was like, okay, whatever has a meaning to him. I didn't really know the basis of it yet, but I just kind of went with it. I've never been in a recording studio. So for me, that was really, really cool. And then to see all these artists that's actually recorded and they, like, their music was born there, it was a really cool experience. There's so much history there. And then also him telling me now the reason why we're doing this and why this song means so much to him and how it ties back into me, it was a completely different understanding and perspective of it. So I really love what we did with the song and the meaning it has for us. And it was a beautiful anniversary thing to do as well. So, yeah.
And having Julian Anderson be the engineer and mix it and record it was great. Jonathan Plum and the rest of the ownership group there mastering it. And it was nice. We had some really good hands on it. We intentionally talked about the song, the structure of the song. We communicated a lot about that without actually playing the song intentionally. We did get together, actually was it the night before, or two nights before, up at Jam Academy in Woodinville, and just to try to figure out what chord we're gonna play it in. Because I wanted it to sound longing, I wanted it to sound desperate. I wanted to barely reach the upper notes, and I think we found it, and it was a B flat. And so we found that, but then going to the studio, we all kind of had the structure in mind, but I wanted to make sure that with the structure in mind that Jim was playing what Jim was feeling and what he wanted to do. Same with Chris, and then same with myself. And it was interesting to be there at such an iconic place, and having not ever played the song, did everything within a couple takes, I believe. It just felt wonderful. We had some emotional times where it was just really just fun. Just felt like God moments every once in a while, just creeping in.
Yeah, that was really a shock to my system to come in unrehearsed as a group. You know, everyone rehearsed on their own at home, showed up, and then lay down the parts there at the studio, and really makes me wonder how a band can write in the studio. It's not what I'm used to. I'm used to rehearsing 2-3 times a week on material and getting it, you know, really, really solid live before we go in and do the takes. So yeah, that was a different experience for me, and I'm actually surprised at how well it did come out.
Oh yeah, he tells me, babe, can you do like a harmony in there somewhere? And I'm like, okay, what do you want me to do? Give me instructions. I'll just come up with something. So thankfully, Jim, a very talented musician, comes over the day before and just helps me do some harmony pieces into the song. I've sang in choir all my life in school, ever since I was young. So I'm used to having, you know, weekly choir practices, and very organized and very, you know, this is what we're doing. But working with these guys that are so talented, it really helped me feel more comfortable and just kind of just go for it and do it. So it was fun, and we had a really nice time.
Well, your harmonies on it were definitely the salt on the project, you know, brought out the flavor of it.
It was fun to throw a little bit of a difference in there. And again, I keep on thinking, if I would have had more time to practice, it could have been better, right? But that's the difference between Rick and I, and it was great at the end anyways, but I was nervous that it wasn't gonna be like, oh my God, like we're gonna just throw it out there for people to hear. But at the end of the day, honestly, it sounds great, and I love how it came out, and my husband did such a good job with the team to do it, or the band, and it was just, it has such a beautiful meaning to it that really means so much more. And now that I know that, it makes a huge difference too, the whole experience of it, like understanding it. So all of us coming together and being able to do something, it was just fun. It was more about being together and everyone bringing a little piece to it, and it just means a lot. So I love that. So it was fun. I'll do it again for sure, yeah.
It'll be interesting to see how this thing all plays out with Unfortunate Things. Really great to reconnect with Rick and with Jeff, and to meet Jim, and to do the work at London Bridge, which was, you know, another high school friend is one of the owners there, and it's been with them for, you know, since early 90s, mid 90s. Oh man. So yeah, it's been exciting so far, and looking forward to see what happens for the future.
I think it broke the seal a little bit for some of us too on recording. It had been years since I had recorded anything, but it was a great time for us to get together with Jim and go do it, and to see that process and how we work together in the studio and how that studio works. And by doing that, it was sort of like dipping our foot in the pool a little bit, because we have some other stuff, some original stuff coming eventually down the line that we'd like to go in and do. And so it was sort of just a trial balloon to see how everything went. And do you have thoughts on that?
I'm just hoping that you'll let me be a part of the band after recording process.
We'll see. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's not looking good, but you know, there's a chance.
I'll practice.
Yeah, it was awesome. It was a great experience. I loved it. I will definitely do it again, and it was awesome. So yeah, thank you, babe.
Yeah.
Well, she was an American girl, raised on promises. She couldn't help thinking that there was a little more life somewhere else. After all, it was a great big world with lots of places to run to. And if she had to die trying, she had one little promise she was gonna keep. Oh yeah, alright, take it easy baby, make it last all night. She was an American girl.